Heavenly Father, you know what you want to be said today, and I pray that I will be your instrument. Lord, that you'll speak through me a message that will be laid upon your people's hearts who are gathered here today, Lord. And we pray, too, that our worship will be pleasing in your sight. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. Well, here we are, folks. We are in the dead of winter this year, and I have a question. How are you doing? How are you dealing with it? Now, I know, saying that several of us have many things going on. You have serious family illnesses going on. Some of you are dealing with death in a family, and it's just been a lot going on in this community lately. But in a general sense, I just wonder, how this has affected us, that we're in this time where it's gloomy and overcast so much of the time. We haven't had any snow, no ice, so to speak, yet, thankfully. But there's a lot of gloom and darkness. So are you energy deprived? You find yourself sleeping longer than usual and not even wanting to get up some days? So are you less productive? Are you a little more irritable lately? It could just be your personality, but of course, there is something that doctors have labeled the SAD, SAD, or seasonal affective disorder. I'm told it affects about 1 out of 5 people, and it all is, has to do with lack of light and the fact that your brain doesn't produce the serotonin that it needs and so forth. And maybe we need to change the location. You know, in New Mexico, for example, I hear there's 310 days of sunlight on average per year. The American Medical Association has recommended what's called light therapy. Light therapy, being exposed to light. Well, I want to talk about light therapy today, but light therapy in terms of a spiritual nature. Because this, to me, is obviously of much greater importance and significance. And since we just came through Christmas, I would suggest we consider Christmas as light therapy. The world, if you think about it, has chronic SAD, spiritual affective disorder. I might be making up a new term there. And I don't know how much you've noticed it, but in Scripture, often Scripture talks about this metaphor of light and darkness. Darkness being the spiritual state of humanity in rebellion against God, our love for sin, if you will. But it talks about it positively, what happens when our eyes, for example, are spiritually opened. When they're spiritually open. Ephesians 5:8, for example, Paul says, "For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the world." And as a result, he says, "Walk as children of light." You know, when a person steps out of darkness and sin, well, this is when they really become truly enlightened. When they see what they couldn't see before with spiritual eyes. It caused John Newton, wrote that great hymn, Amazing Grace, to proclaim, "I once was blind, but now I see." Well, our gospel text for today not only talks about spiritual light and darkness, it provides the opening debut. This is the opening act for Jesus' ministry. He goes to Galilee, and Matthew uses the metaphor of light and darkness. And there's three simple things, three that I'd like you to notice in this. Number one, the darkness was predicted. It was predicted. Number two, the darkness was profound. And number three, the darkness was penetrated. I'll be dealing with these three characteristics of darkness, but first, I wanted to highlight how I think some of us react to this whole idea that there seems to be increasing spiritual darkness in the world. Have you ever noticed, for example, some people, some Christians are very self-loathing. They get all caught up in how bad the world really is. And the state of the world becomes a source of constant discussion and just hand-wringing. It was my very own mother who made a statement a few years ago that totally surprised me. She said she just didn't like the direction the world was heading, and she explained, therefore, she was ready to leave it. She was ready to die. Made me think, perhaps what we need here is a reality check. A reality check. Yeah, the days could be getting darker And as they get darker, though, I get more and more optimistic. Because the darker it gets, the brighter the light of Christ shines. Okay, and the Word of God promises us all that to Jesus goes the final victory. So we're called here, folks, to pay more attention to what's written in Scripture than what the news media is saying all around us. Because the Scriptures have a lot of good news to people who are living in darkness. For example, in our gospel text, we find preparation for ministries has been done. John, who was to prepare for the coming of the Messiah King, his ministry has come to an end. He's been arrested. He got arrested, by the way, because he preached a hard message. No one ever got arrested for sugarcoating stuff, right? Just as well as nobody ever got arrested for being politically correct. He got arrested for truth-telling. And his concern, it wasn't with diplomacy, but it was with telling the truth. So the preparation for the arrival of the kingdom of God, which John set up, is done. And secondly, we said there was a coronation of Jesus. He's the leader of the dawning kingdom of God. I talked about that a few weeks ago. If you recall, we talked about Jesus's coronation at his baptism when he's affirmed by the Father and the Holy Spirit. Now, Jesus is moving to Galilee, fully intent on expanding his kingdom and his dominion when John is arrested. By the way, that's a sign. That's a forecasting of what's going to happen to Jesus. But instead of going to Nazareth, where Jesus grew up, he goes to this place called Capernaum. And then we're told that it's in this territory, it's strangely enough, hardly ever mentioned at all, of Zebulun and Naphtali. What's that all about? That's the northwest region of the Sea of Galilee. It's the northern section, if you will, of the land of Israel. And it's noteworthy. Jesus goes to the darkest, spiritually darkest region of Israel. Why? It was the most ignorant, poverty-stricken, backwards region of the whole nation. We get a hint in verse 14 as to why. It says, so that what was spoken might be fulfilled. Isaiah had prophesied it. Lawrence read it for us back in Isaiah 9. And Matthew quotes in our text today, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people dwelling in darkness have seen a great light. And for those dwelling in the region of the shadow of death, on them light has dawned. That is an amazing passage to me. Should be to you. Why? Understanding the context of Scripture is everything. It makes all the difference, and it makes it come alive, if you will. Matthew is telling us, I want you to know the history and recall why these words were spoken by Isaiah in the first place. What you may not know or may have forgotten is that the land of Zebulun and Naphtali, they were amongst the tribes to be established in the northern kingdom of Israel when the Jews entered the promised land. And it so happens that eventually, due to great sin and disobedience, they were conquered by the Assyrians. If you were to read Isaiah 8, I hope you will go back and do this, there's a dismal description of the land of Zebulun and Naphtali, which had received the judgment of God. The invading Assyrian army came from the north. They reached these lands first and conquered them, bringing their religious idolatry, their loose living, their immorality into the land. Now, suddenly, Matthew reports this land was going to be restored, as dark as it was, with the light of God. We are, so to speak, at ground zero, the place where God's covenant judgment had fallen 7 centuries before. This text gives me a great deal of hope. Gives me hope because there's no place where Jesus doesn't make his light shine. And in fact, my Jesus deliberately seeks out the dark places of the world to shine his brilliant light. He doesn't go to the Bible Belt, if you will. This is what so many people, I feel, don't get about themselves personally, or why, about why a desperate and dark place such as Haiti can become a place of great hope. Why does this happen? Well, I believe we think Sometimes our lives are beyond the pale. We've made so many mistakes before God, we say. He would never want me. And to that I say, everybody that uses that excuse better find another excuse, because my God is the furthest away from that attitude of anything that I know. My God runs to the darkness out of his great passion. And that's why, as I was standing there in the streets of Port-au-Prince, Haiti, amidst poverty and chaos, burning garbage along the streets, some of the worst, pathetic, poverty-stricken things you've ever seen, I think I felt the presence of God more than I ever had before. And some of you might be in a dark place today. Maybe you're full of guilt for your sins, or maybe you're so engaged in sin you don't even feel guilt anymore. You're just numb to it. Perhaps you're addicted to pornography or drugs or alcohol, and here you are. But if God can move in Galilee of the Gentiles, take note. It wasn't Galilee of the Jews or the Hebrews. They were the in crowd. They were the popular ones. He goes to Galilee amongst the unpopular ones. He can move in your life as well. If God can move in dark places, do you not think he could move in your home, in your family, in your marriage? Of course he can. So if we go back to verse 16, these people who dwelt in darkness, we're told, have seen a great light. On them, he says, light has dawned. They were in spiritual darkness. They had no fear of God. They were ignorant, had very little spiritual knowledge. They were backwards, but when it happens that the light of God appears, it's a new day. That's what Matthew's telling us. This pagan-dominated culture in northern Israel has a new day dawning right in front of it, in its midst. So, I said the spiritual darkness was predicted of this land. Secondly, I said it was profound. God's people had become disobedient, and disobedience reached a new low back in the time of Isaiah. I don't know how many of you have studied it, but there was a king. His name was King Ahaz. Now, you'd think he would know better. He was a king, a Jewish king. He introduced, of all things, worship of the pagan god Molech. Okay, this was a god worshipped by the Canaanites, who the Israelites had conquered. Molech was this metallic-looking statue with arms outstretched and a beast-like face. Do you know what they would do with this? They would heat him up to insanely high temperatures and then place child sacrifices in Molech's arms to be fried to death. Ahaz himself had his own son sacrificed to Molech, if you can believe it. During the time, some people were believing in witchcraft and many other forms of evil. And so this is a profound text. Matthew is communicating to us something very, very profound about this land. The spiritual darkness is so significant and so deep that Matthew tells us they sat in darkness. Isaiah, if you'll notice in the text, says they walked in darkness. But do you get the picture here? It's like you're wandering around so much and so lost that you can't even wander anymore, so you just sit. There were some caves in Ohio near my previous church. And at one point, if you took a tour, the tour guide would tell us when he or she turned out the lights, we would be in a state of total darkness. This was the kind of darkness where you couldn't even see your hand in front of your face. And I'm told that if you're in darkness too long, you can actually lose the power to adapt. You become blind, and you get to a point, if you're in it long enough, where you cannot recover. When Jesus came into this world, into Galilee, it was dark politically at that time. The free world, okay, Rome was in charge, but the Roman soldiers watched your every move. Pax Romana was really peace of the Roman fist. Out of this came the zealots, who failed miserably to try and overthrow the Romans. The political darkness was profound. There was also economic darkness. Rome had devised this very ingenious system of taxation. If you think we have it bad, It was great if you were a Roman official. If not, it killed you. They used a system called tax farming, in which the power to tax was given to the highest bidder of that region. There was a minimum to be given to Rome, but then you were told if you can get any more off the top, you can keep as much as you can possibly collect. Nobody knew what the tax rate really was. There was the poll tax. That involved females ages 14 to 65, males ages 16 to 65. That was a tax you paid just to breathe Roman air. Okay? Then there was the income tax, flat 10% off of your total income. There was then the road tax, the harbor tax, the import tax, the ground tax. You had to pay tax on 1/10 of the grain, 1/5 of the wine. All of it went to Rome. If you lived by a body of water, believe it or not, you paid a fish tax. And there was a cart tax, and it was based on how many wheels were on the cart that you were using. Number three, there was moral darkness. Ancient world, Jesus' day, morally corrupt. Greco-Roman world was morally askew. Average Greek housewife, okay, she would have to stay home. Ladies, if you think about this, in almost total seclusion, she couldn't go out publicly. She had to attain the highest moral standard, whereas Greco-Roman men, they had to follow no standard. They could sleep with as many women as they wanted. Demosthenes wrote back then, "We have courtesans for the sake of pleasure, concubines for the sake of daily cohabitation, and wives for the purpose of having legitimate children and to have faithful guardians for all of our household affairs." How's that for inequality? But the most profound darkness, well, that we're talking was spiritual darkness. Before Jesus came, there had been no prophet of God for 400 years, four centuries. And one day Jesus comes and the light breaks forth. Historians tell us that prior to Jesus' coming, there was this groundswell of expectation among the Jews that a deliverer was coming. There was a national and international longing for the Messiah. Well, you may say the ancient world sounds an awful lot like our world today, right? So did Jesus' coming even really mean that much? Have things really changed? Things seem to stay the same or get worse after Christmas. Everybody goes back to life as usual. The Bible says it this way: light has come into the world, but men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. They prefer darkness. It was 1864, at the height of the Civil War, one cold, dark winter when Confederate troops, under the command of Robert E. Lee, were dealing with all the horrors of war. Word came to the Southerners that General George Pickett's wife had a baby boy. When Lee found out about it, he said, "Let's celebrate." And he commanded fires to be lit by the Southern troops along their flanks. Now, the Northerners saw the fires and wondered what was up. They found out, discovered that these were celebratory fires, and Ulysses Grant, who of course was commanding the Northern troops, knew Pickett from the military academy. He decided to celebrate along with the Confederate soldiers, and so ordered fires to be lit in celebration for one night. If you will, one night, the opposing forces laid down their arms and were at peace, only to do what? Pick them up the next day and go back to fighting, killing, and so forth. With Jesus, the darkness was parted for eternity. That's the point of this text. Light has dawned. Isaiah predicted light would come, and it came by Jesus Christ preaching truth. Repentance from sin. And I just want to say a quick word about repentance. It is a prerequirement for enlightenment. If you want to be enlightened, think repentance. Nothing happens when people in darkness stay in it, right? But when people in darkness decide, "I'm going to turn around, I'm going to reorient my life, I'm going to go in a different direction," that's when life begins to change. So how does the light shine? We're told in verse 17, Jesus began to preach. Go figure. Light comes through hearing the Word of God, the preaching of the Word. I know people want me to do sometimes shorter sermons, but do you realize the importance of the preaching of the Word? And it happened all the way back in the beginning of Genesis. To remember, there was nothing but darkness. God creates light. How does He create light? Through His Word. But they love darkness. You know, it's like when you're in a dark room. What happens when somebody turns on the light? You're flailing around going, the light hurts my eyes. I want to stay in the dark. And that's what happens to us spiritually. We want to stay in the dark longer than we should because we grow accustomed to it. That's the situation many people find themselves in today spiritually. You can't, though. You can't get cleansed from sin by denying that you have it. And walking away back into the shadows, brushing yourself off, you know, doing some self-help religious practice. It's only by repentance. When you think about it, to kind of sum all of this up, the Old Testament offered only flickers of light. But when you get to this passage, okay, this passage, this gospel text, you get full-on sunrise. Jesus' light compels people. It draws people to follow Him. That's what happened with the disciples. Did you pick up on what I read there? They immediately dropped what they were doing and followed Him because Jesus compelled them to do so. And yes, the world may look increasingly dark, but the light of Christ, it's shining ever brighter in the darkness. And don't ever lose sight of that wonderful promise of Scripture. Do you remember it in John chapter 1? The light, which is Jesus, shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. That's the best news of all. That's Jesus shares that light with us. And you know what that makes us? It makes us light bearers. Light bearers. Let's own it. Amen. Hello, I'm Pastor Kent Hollis. I hope this message was meaningful to you and touched your heart in some way. We encourage you to check out our website at sjlcmetro.com. That's sjlcmetro.com. You can get further information regarding our ministry here at St. John Lutheran Church. And may the Lord bless you richly as you seek to be in relationship with Him.